Haven't you ever heard that? The kid asked, almost wild-eyed. Two on a match, it's unlucky. Three on a match is unlucky, I said. Adam squinted at me. Are you superstitious too? I looked hard at Broker, who merely shrugged. I gotta pee, the kid said suddenly, and had the broker let him slide out. Standing, he wasn't very big, probably 5'7", skinny. His jeans were tattered. When we were alone, I said, what are you doing, hooking me up with that dumbass jerk? Give him a chance. He was in Vietnam like you. He's not completely inexperienced. Most of the guys I knew in Vietnam were stoned 24 hours a day. That's not what I'm looking for in a partner. He's just a little green. You'll season him. I'll ice him if he fucks up, understood? The broker shrugged. Understood. When Adam came back, Broker let him in and said, the hardest part is you have a window of only 4 days. That's bad, I said, frowning. I like to maintain a surveillance, get a pattern down. The broker shrugged again. It's a different situation. They're on vacation. They won't have much of a pattern. Great. Now the broker frowned. Why in hell you think it pays so well? Think of it as hazardous duty pay. Adam sneered and said, what's the matter, Quarry? Didn't you never take no fucking risks? I think I'm about to, I said. It'll go well, the broker said. Knock on wood, the kid said, and rapped on the table. That's for Micah, I said. The Wistful Wagon Lodge sprawled out over numerous wooded acres, just off the outskirts of Wistful Vista, Illinois. According to the broker's brochure, back in the late 40s, the hamlet had taken the name of Fibber McGee and Molly's fictional hometown for purposes of attracting tourists. Apparently one of the secondary stars of the radio show had been born nearby. This marketing ploy had been just in time for television making radio passé, and the little farm community's only remaining sign of having at all successfully tapped into the tourist trade was the Wistful Wagon Lodge itself. A cobblestone drive wound through the scattering of log cabins and several larger buildings, including the main lodge where the check-in and restaurants were similarly rustic structures but of gray-weathered wood. Trees clustered everywhere, turning warm sunlight into cool pools of shade. Wood-burned signs showed the way to this building or that path, and decorative wagon wheels, often with flower beds in and around them, were scattered about as if some long-ago pioneer mishap had been beautified by nature and time. Of course, that wasn't the case. This was the hokey hand of man. We arrived separately, Adam and I, each having reserved rooms in advance, each paying cash up front upon registration, no credit cards. We each had log cabin cottages, not terribly close to one another. As the backup and surveillance man, Adam went in early. The target and his wife were taking a long weekend, arriving Thursday, leaving Monday. I didn't arrive until Saturday morning. I went to Adam's cabin and knocked, but got no answer, which just meant he was trailing Mr. and Mrs. Target around the grounds. After I dropped my stuff off at my own cabin, I wandered, trying to get the general layout of the place, checking out the lodge itself, where about half of the rooms were, as well as two restaurants. Everything had a pine smell, which was partially the many trees and partially pine sol. Wistful Wagon was Hollywood rustic. There was a dated quality about it, from the cowboy, cowgirl attire of the waiters and waitresses in the Wistful Chuck Wagon Cafe, to the wood and leather furnishings, to the barnwood-framed Remington prints. I got myself some lunch and traded smiles with a giggly table full of college girls who were on a weekend scouting expedition of their own. Good, I thought. If I can connect with one of them tonight, that'll provide nice cover. As I was finishing up, my cowgirl waitress, a curly-haired blonde pushing 30, who was pretty cute herself, said, "Looks like you might get lucky tonight." She was refilling my coffee cup. "With them or with you?" I asked. She had big washed-out blue eyes and heavy eye makeup, more 60s than 70s. She was wearing a 1950s-style cowboy hat cinched under her chin. I'm not supposed to fraternize with the guests. "How did you know I was a fraternity man?" She laughed a little, her chin crinkled. Her face was kind of round, and she was a little pudgy, nicely so, in the bosom. "Wild stab," she said. "Anyway, there's an open dance in the ballroom of the wagon train dining room. Country swing band. You'll like it." You inviting me? No, she said. She narrowed her eyes and cocked her head, her expression one of mild scolding. Those little girls will be there, and plenty of others. You won't have any trouble finding what you want. I bet I will. Why's that? I was hoping for a girl wearing cowboy boots like yours. Oh, there'll be girls in cowboy boots there tonight. I meant just cowboy boots. She laughed at that, shook her head. Under her Dale Evans hat, her blonde curls bounced off her shoulders. She went away and let me finish my coffee, and I smiled at the college girls some more, but when I paid for my check at the register, it was my plump little cowgirl again. I work late tonight, she said. How late? I get off at midnight, she said. That's only the first time, I said. First time what? That you'll get off tonight. She liked that. Times were different then. The only way you could die from fucking was if a husband or a boyfriend caught you at it. She told me where to meet her later. I strolled back up a winding path to my cabin. A few groups of college girls and college guys not paired off together yet were buzzing around. Some couples in their 20s and up into their 60s were walking, often hand in hand, around the sun-dappled, lushly shaded grounds. The sound of a gentle breeze in the trees made a faint, shimmering music. Getting laid here was no trick. I got my swim trunks on and grabbed a towel and headed for the nearest pool, which was the outdoor one. That's where I found Adam. He did look like a college frat rat with his shorter hair, his skinny, pale body reddening. He was sitting in a deck chair sipping a Coke and sunglasses and racing trunks, chatting with a couple of bikinied college cuties, also in sunglasses.